Human Resource Management. Coming to you tonight, we're live, Tuesday, January 9th, 2018. It's our 77th program. We're in our 12th year. Thank you for watching. We are live tonight. 610-378-0426 is the call-in number for home viewers with your questions and comments and general complaints. Our program tonight is brought to you as an underwriter by Moss Teller & Associates, a full-service professional human resource consulting firm. They assist organizations of all sizes and all sectors of our area, and they can be found out at 2433 Morgantown Road, Suite 100, Route 10, and their telephone number 610-779-3870, and their information will be flashed onto the screen at the bottom of the program as well. We thank Moss Teller & Associates and Chet especially for their support. The program tonight is Harassment and Retaliation, and we designed it primarily in response to all the sensational news we've been seeing, although we can't bring you any firsthand experiences in the world of Hollywood or politics. However, the working world, we assure you such things still do exist, and we hope to give you a good outline of those topics and the substantive issues surrounding them. The panel we have tonight, a most august panel that we have some first-timers here who are very experienced nonetheless and have a lot to offer, and we have one of our panelists who's been on many of the programs and is an old salt with this. So, to my immediate left is Debra Franklin. She's Vice President of Human Resources Solutions for Murray Securus, which is a benefits and human resource management firm.
And insurance, that's right.
They have six offices in the Mid-Atlantic region. She received her JD degree from SUNY at Buffalo and has 30 years of practical experience in this exact field. So welcome, and we hope to have you back.
Thank you very much.
In the middle of the panelists then, we have Joan London, who certainly know she's been on the program before, and she's also on a number of programs here, Ask the Lawyer, and she's presented at numerous Society of Human Resource Management meetings. Her employment law concentration benefits her in that regard. She's also the Berks County Bar president, had been vice president, and she corrected me this afternoon out there that she's now the president. And she's a published author, her JD degree from Dickinson School of Law, and she's admitted to the bar in Berks County, the Pennsylvania U.S. District Courts, and up to the Supreme Court. So welcome back.
Thank you, Bob. This is the first time I've ever been called an old salt. I'm impressed.
Well,
thank you.
Well, from a Marine, you know, that's a compliment.
I know. Thank you very much.
And to my far left, Jenny Batista. Jenny's a corporate... are in your title. We welcome small business owners who have human resource management challenges and know where to turn, attorneys, and even those entities who service the human resource management profession. Our chapter averages about 170 members. We have representation from just about every company out there that has HR people in it. We meet monthly. We have monthly breakfast meetings the second Tuesday of every month. If you would like to be invited in to see who we are, you know how to contact us now. That was on the screen, and it'll show again for you. We try to give back to the community. We have a dinner out at the Olivets, or the Police Athletic League, formerly called that, on 4th Street. Actually, it's 4th and Walnut, I believe, or near there. And we sponsor a holiday dinner there. We certainly provide this service on an every other month basis to the community at large. We also have lunch and learns at the Greater Reading Chamber of Commerce and Industry over the lunchtime for people who can't make it to our early morning meetings. We also provide this Diversity and Inclusion Committee. We have an Engagement Committee and a Community Relations Committee, and we're just now involved with some efforts up at Reading High School with some of their students. As with any profession, there are certifications that are available that manifests a person's commitment to the profession and competencies therein. And we also run a certification study group for our members who wish to pursue those certifications. And with that, we'll move on to our topic tonight. We have a lot of information to share, harassment and retaliation. Last year, there were over 12,000 sexual harassment allegations to the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission. That's just to the federal level. Who knows how many in state and local areas. And folks, that's 32 every day somewhere in the country. So it's basically more than one an hour all year long, and that's just sexual harassment. So
that's before Harvey Weinstein.
And that was before Harvey and anybody
we'll
else.
We'll see a blip up from there.
I think so.
So I guess what I'd like to do is first ask Joan, we don't want to get into a lot of discrimination issues, but we can't really talk about harassment without talking about discrimination. Could you get us started with that?
Sure. Harassment is just one subset of discrimination. Discrimination is treating people differently, in a negatively different way, because of some characteristic that's protected under federal law. It can be a person's sex, it can be a person's age, their race, their skin color, their religion, their disability, even now their genetic information. All of these things, if taken into account in hiring, in firing, in discipline, demotion, compensation, terms and conditions of employment, anything to do with the employment process where one person based on one of these protected characteristics is treated differently, that's discrimination. And that's illegal under federal and state law.
Now, there's some things though that just because it's happening that way could result in some kind of disparate treatment, or disparate impact, but there's a difference between disparate impact and disparate treatment.
There is. Sometimes a rule can be neutral on its face. Mm-hmm. However, it can tend to screen out certain people. For example, in a job, there may be a heavy lifting requirement. We know that generally men have more upper body strength than women. So that requirement may tend to screen out women from certain jobs involving heavy lifting. The question then becomes, is it what's called a bona fide occupational qualification? Mm-hmm. Is this lifting, for example, is that an essential function of the position? If it is, there may be a disparate impact, and there may be more males in the job than females, maybe more overwhelmingly so, but that's not unlawful discrimination. Where it becomes unlawful discrimination is where a requirement is woven into a job mm-hmm. that's not necessary for the purpose of or having the result of screening out certain protected characteristics such as sex or age. Race is almost never considered a bona fide occupational qualification.
Right.
In other cases, with age, for example, with mandatory retirement for pilots, that's one example. In those cases, there's a safety reason for it. There's a rational safety-related reason for it, so it becomes a bona fide occupational qualification.
Okay, well, thank you. That's a good opening for this entire topic we're going to jump into. If I could ask Debra here, there's a plethora of laws, statutes, if you will, at all levels. The city of Reading has a human relations commission, and the state certainly has a human relations commission. I don't know if there's state laws like there are EEOC laws. Could you give us an overview of the panoply of these regulations, laws, whatever, that employers better be mindful of?
Sure, Bob. And that's actually a really great question, because increasingly there are more and more state and local laws that we're seeing being promulgated by state and local agencies in areas where maybe the federal government hasn't necessarily moved as quickly as some states and localities would like. We're seeing this particularly in the area of sexual orientation and gender preference. So a number of states and localities have promulgated their own laws prohibiting discrimination based on gender preference or LGBTQ status. And employers really do need to be mindful of what the laws are in every area where they do business. And this is a particularly challenging issue for employers with multiple locations, of course, particularly where they cross states. And it impacts handbooks more than one might think, because if an employer is operating in different localities that have different statutes, the employees need to have handbook policies and provisions that are compliant with the laws of the localities where they're located.
And it's right really in the tri-state area, because, for example, the New Jersey law against discrimination has a broader focus than the Pennsylvania Human Relations Act, especially as far as sexual orientation. But even locally, the Reading and Allentown human relations ordinances go further than the Pennsylvania Human Relations Act. And if you do business in the city of Reading or Allentown, those are applicable to you regardless of where your headquarters might be.
Correct. And Lancaster and Harrisburg have their own laws. Even towns, I mean, not just cities, but even certain towns now are promulgating their own laws. And so it's a real challenge for employers to keep up with that and make sure that they really are in compliance. Another area where we see that is with Family Medical Leave Act and a lot of states applying their own standards. And New Jersey in particular is one that has, Pennsylvania doesn't have its own act, but New Jersey does. And retaliation is one of the largest litigation areas within FMLA.
That's what I was going to ask you next is, this, it seems on the surface to be so vaporous and amorphous, but what is retaliation, and how do you know when it's retaliation or a terminated employee or an employee who has an adverse employment action is just upset enough and angry enough to complain, and there's a complaint process, which we'll get into briefly, versus actual retaliation that the employer was just that stupid?
Well, retaliation is punishment for engaging in a protected activity. Making a complaint of discrimination or harassment, for example, is a protected activity, whether it's to management, to HR, or to an agency. That's cooperating in an investigation. A coworker claims to have been sexually harassed, and management asks you about it as part of their investigation. If you cooperate and your boss changes your hours, makes your terms and conditions of employment less desirable, something that would deter, and court cases have said this, deter a normal person from making the complaint or participating in the activity. That's retaliation. And it's the classic case, really, of the cover-up being worse than the crime. It appears we have a home viewer.
Okay, yes, home viewer, can I have your first name, please?
Yes, it's Julie.
Julie, what can we do for you tonight?
Yes, I'm hoping that you can give some advice about how employers can hold employees at all levels accountable for poor behavior.
Well, thank you. It's a great question. Now, I neglected to provide our disclaimer at the top of the program that nothing here is meant to be legal advice, and the opinions are of our panelists and not of our employers. So with that preface, who wants to handle this one?
I'll take it.
Okay, go right ahead.
So, Julie, I understand that what you're really addressing here is performance management, and performance management is going to cover all behavior of employees at work, including their conduct, which is the topic of our discussion this evening in terms of harassment and retaliation. But it covers much more than that. It really is going to cover all areas of performance. And I think that the best way for an employer to ensure that employee behavior is appropriate at all times and oriented towards the work that the employee is there to perform is to have good, solid policies, and even more importantly, a great culture where from the leadership at the very top of the organization all the way through the management and supervisory levels of that organization, down through all of the employees, the communication is, we're all here to do a job, this is our mission, this is how we're going to get from point A to point B, and this is the way we're going to do it. These are the behaviors that we expect you to demonstrate at work, and these are behaviors that we find are inappropriate for you to display at work. That can be done through a handbook, but it also needs to be reinforced by everyday behavior and leadership.
Sort of a lead by example kind of culture. We're a professional workplace, let's keep it that way.
And a lot of feedback. I'm a firm believer that, you know, if there is something going on, you need to address it, and proper feedback, direct feedback behind closed doors is probably a big deterrent as well. If you're going to catch somebody doing something that maybe they're not aware of, that feedback, that one-on-one feedback, is probably going to get them a good course correction.
And also, it's a matter of letting employees know, too, that they can report discrimination, bad behavior, sexual harassment, or suspected sexual harassment, and there will be no retaliation for the complaint. It will be investigated. It will be taken seriously.
And that's critically important, Jen. And I think that, at least in my experience, a lot of companies have that policy. But what we're beginning to discover in the last several months is that as a society, we haven't done a wonderful job of walking that talk. And employees really haven't felt that it's safe to complain. Yeah. Right. And so, in my practice, what I've learned is that that message really has to be demonstrated every day by every leader and manager in that organization, and that you have to stick to it. It has to be consistent because you have to develop the trust of your workforce.
Julie, is this where you were headed with your answer? Have we helped?
I was, yes. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you for your call. We have another home viewer. Can I have your first name, please? Hello?
Hello.
Can I have your first name, please?
My name is Scott.
Scott, thank you for the call. And what's your question or comment?
My question is, what is governing companies to not judge or what happens with employees that have actual difficulties?
When you say difficulties, are we talking about behavioral issues, medical issues, physical issues?
Well, just issues overall, as far as, you know, if an individual has a problem, you know, what's governing private companies from, you know, human resource from not being able to discriminate? Who's governing that?
I think what you're asking, Scott, is about what are the laws that are governing private employers as opposed to government employers. Is that what you're asking?
Right. Like a simple employee, like, you know, a typical company, that, you know, who's governing them that they're making the correct decisions?
Well, the laws that govern, there are federal and state laws. In Pennsylvania, we have the Pennsylvania Human Relations Act, which prohibits discrimination on the same basis as federal law: sex, race, religion, age, disability, and that is enforced by the Pennsylvania Human Relations Commission. Under federal law, we have Title VII of the Civil Rights Act of 1964. We have laws requiring equal pay for equal work between the sexes, the Equal Pay Act. We have laws against age discrimination, the Age Discrimination Employment Act. We have Genetic Information Non-Discrimination Act. We have a variety of federal laws, and those are enforced by the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission.
Right. Now, one more, maybe, that is testing, like testing that does between, some companies do testing between Hispanic and bilingual, you know, for companies. And some can't do one or the other as well or as fast. And the testing, I know, overall is hard.
Well, are you, so, Scott, are you asking about if an employer has, they put in the advertisement for the job, bilingual preferred?
Right.
And that's, right. Well, if most of my business is being done in a heavily Hispanic population, customer base, or neighborhood.
Well, I know that one of your panel members has to deal with bilingual, but they, for some reason, they can't transfer over as far as, like, timing, like the timing of the test.
I can speak, Jenny, to that. It boils down to what's on the job description, right? So if you are requiring someone to read and write and communicate in both languages, they must, you know, some companies do have a test that will allow you to show your proficiency, and this is part of the job description. And if you cannot pass one or the other or both, then, you know, the company doesn't move forward because that is part of the job description. So everything always falls back on the job description. So essential functions, as you were speaking of,
right,
it
like
all falls
testing.
Back on that. Yep, it all falls back on that. If it's outlined there that is a requirement, just like the lifting mm-hmm. you talked yeah. about, or, you know, you must climb, you know, 75 feet up in the air, obviously with OSHA protected, you know, PPE, you still, those are the requirements. So.
Scott, I can tell you that with as far as tests and interviews
okay,
or tests...
Okay, I see that Jenny Batista's doing it now on there.
Yeah. With testing, it has to meet two standards. One is validity and one is reliability. Mm-hmm. And most of those are documented through a number of different processes to be sure that we are requiring what's necessary, but not putting things in there so that on the surface it looks neutral, like Joan said, but there's a disparate impact regardless of the intent to have it be valid, but it's the way it worked out. But mostly reliability and validity are standards in HR that apply to performance appraisals, selection tools, job descriptions, and employment tests. Mm-hmm. So,
Right.
And when you're talking okay. about testing, it is required that the tests be neutral, and it's best that they be professionally designed to be neutral.
Okay. Well, if that's the point, then I hope we've helped your concern out here and answered it as best we could. Thank you for the call. And so we'll move on to some other topics now. We want to try to get into the topic on the news lately was sexual harassment and retaliation, and there's so many issues around this. The standard, if you looked at Mad Men when the television show was on, that was an HR attorney's playground, I suppose.
But Title VII.
we had the concepts of quid pro quo, and I'll ask Deb to maybe address that, and hostile work environment, which maybe then I'll ask Jen and Joan to address.
Sure, Bob. So quid pro quo harassment is sort of more of what we saw in Mad Men before Title VII was put into place. Literally in Latin, quid pro quo means this for that. Mm-hmm. And so quid pro quo harassment is literally making submission to a sexual request a condition for something else. If you go on a date with me, I will promote you. Mm-hmm. If you don't go on a date with me, I will not promote you or I will fire you. So this mm-hmm. is what we saw, you know, many, many years ago. Unfortunately, just when we thought that maybe it had seen its heyday and was waning, Harvey Weinstein peeked mm-hmm. his head up, and we found out that it's still out there. So mm-hmm. the casting couch was very mm-hmm. much a quid pro quo situation.
Okay. Okay. How about hostile work environment then? Because I would think that almost any form of harassment creates a hostile work environment.
It does. And a lot of times, you know, it goes hand in hand with retaliation. So, you know, a supervisor maybe or a coworker might make a hostile work environment if someone is not doing a quid pro quo or you know doing favors or you know asking somebody to cover for you while you're doing something else and so the hostile work environment comes in when you are when that person is being offended by the things you are doing specifically to them to make their life miserable for them not to want to come to work for them to want to quit. And there is a variety of things that people have done, you know, from calling people names to, you know, sabotaging the work that they're doing, breaking equipment so that they can't work and they can't get their numbers in, things like that. So it makes for a very miserable time for the person that's being harassed.
But there are other things, too, that are also a hostile work environment. When you have a lot of offensive jokes, slurs, offensive references to body parts, things that show disrespect to one sex or the other, or even outside of sexual harassment, to different racial, ethnic, and religious groups. When you have a constant barrage of insults, the court cases have referred to workplaces so permeated with hostility, insults, and ridicule that a normal person would find it intolerable. That's a hostile work environment.
That's a great point. So one of the things I was going to ask the panel is, when is a distasteful joke or a reference or never mind physical activity, touching kind of thing? We'll get into that later. Mm-hmm. But some of these comments you're mentioning, when does it go from something that was just in poor taste and ungentlemanly or unladylike to sexual harassment? Where's the bar?
And that's a good point because the courts use a test called severe and pervasive. Mm-hmm. They're not going to make sexual harassment of every tasteless joke, of every swear word in the workplace, minor teasing, workplace banter, that kind of thing. They're not going to call that sexual harassment. It's over time when a workplace becomes so insulting and discriminatory. That's the point at which courts are going to find illegal harassment. What the courts are saying is that Title VII is not a workplace civility code. There's no requirement that you be a polite or nice person. It's better if you are, but the law's not going to hold you to that.
But 2 points. Number one, there was a recent Pennsylvania case where the court actually changed that standard here in our jurisdiction and held that the standard is no longer severe and pervasive. It's now severe or pervasive. Mm-hmm. And that's a That's a significant shift in favor of plaintiffs, in favor of those complaining. And I think that the message that that ought to be communicating to employers is, don't worry so much about when you hit that line. Get out in front of that line. Because employers have the ability to craft a culture where behavior that doesn't necessarily rise to the level of illegal harassment is nevertheless unacceptable in the workplace.
I know one of the, in our performance appraisal tool, we have in there specifically for people to, one of the metrics is on, one of the topics is communication, and the metrics are respectful, productive, straightforward, and you know, it's easy then to identify when it doesn't happen. It's just the key to the success of any of these compliance programs, unfortunately, is not the executive, although top management support's critical. They're not there every day doing that, except in their own ivory tower, maybe. And it ought to be with the HR people who are invested in it and trained in it. Unfortunately, it's the supervisors who have a job to do, and they get sometimes a little upset about people who maybe don't look like them, act like them, went to their school, and suddenly these things start percolating, and then they permeate, and the culture starts getting tattered.
One of the things that we have found to be very helpful to some of our clients, and it really came from the schools, is to get out in front, not just focus on doing anti-harassment training, but to also do anti-bullying training.
Well, and I was going to ask that about violence. Eventually, we get into workplace violence. But Jenny, I wanted to ask you, how do we, as a company, as executives, as HR people, how do we go about, sounds like we're trying to set boundaries, which shocks the conscience in a way, because it should be ladies and gentlemen working with ladies and gentlemen, however you define that. But how do you set boundaries to say one tasteless joke is one tasteless joke too many? How do you do that?
Well, along with the training, there has to be communication, and they have to understand what is allowed and what is not allowed. I think it really, everyone has to understand that they have the ability to tell someone to stop. And a lot of times, they won't, because they're afraid. They're afraid either they're going to lose their job, or they're afraid of retaliation from this person or this, you know, a group of people. So I think it's very important, you know, for everybody to know that they have that power. They can say, you need to stop. I am offended. I no longer want to hear this.
Without going ballistic the first time.
Right, okay. Right. But, I mean, it depends on the severity, too, and how offended the person is. Because if it's really bad that the person goes in, you know, behind closed doors and has to cry because they were so hurt by the, you know, by what they were told or that was said about them, you know, it could escalate very quickly.
Well, and even a single incident, in some cases, courts
traumatic.
Have found even a single incident, if sufficiently severe,
or pervasive,
but sufficiently severe, though. I mean, for example, an assault,
correct?
Display of certain racially offensive symbols, like a noose, for example. Even an isolated incident like that, if sufficiently severe, and generally, when there is one incident that's severe, it's a symptom of a greater disease.
Well, in the time we have here in the second half of the program, we teased the audience by saying how we're going to get into sexual harassment. And if we can shift to that primarily for a moment, there's preventive practices, there's training, there's policies, communicate the policies to people, emphasizing the impact on people in the company. Some people call it in-the-moment training. What would you do if, and you describe sexual harassment or potentially sexual harassment behaviors, and I guess what happens, or what should HR people do when they hear of it. They hear of it through secondhand. The complainant actually comes to HR. What's the sequence of events that ought to happen? Jenny, you want to start, and we'll just go down the panel here.
Sure. Investigation is the first thing that comes to mind, because if one person has raised a concern, it's a concern to that person, and it's important enough for them to come to someone and tell someone. So you need to start an investigation, and you have to be, with your investigation, you have to be very, very specific in what you're looking to do, who you're looking to you have to interview people, because there will be more than one person that has heard what went on, if there is, and it has to be a very structured, methodical way to approach and to mm-hmm. get through the investigation, so that you show that you have been very thorough, and that you have gathered all of the information necessary to make the decision at the end.
And timely, I guess.
Yes, very timely, because okay. you don't want to let it go until something else happens.
And okay. I just want to interject, because there are cases where the initial determination involves whether or not that investigation should be handled internally, mm-hmm. or whether a third party should be contacted to conduct that mm-hmm. investigation.
And right.
Certainly in many cases, it's very appropriate for HR to begin that process and to get it started. But there are occasions where that is not the most appropriate course. And so what I always recommend is contact your HR consultant or employment counsel and have a conversation with them about the best way to proceed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because sometimes it is more intimidating to have the boss ask than have an outside attorney or an outside HR consultant ask.
And that's particularly true, I think, in smaller organizations where there are fewer layers.
Well certainly any harassment and discrimination policy should have a complaint process.
Yes.
And we would like to assume that the HR people aren't the harassers, so that they would be excluded from that investigation and that complaint process. But assuming that that's correct, the investigations, what do we do about false allegations? Have you come across that at all?
Yes.
Okay. Jenny, what happened?
It was an allegation of discrimination. All the parties that were mentioned in the initial interview from the person feeling that they were being discriminated against, in the investigation, a lot of things, come into play that have nothing to do with the actual point of discrimination. So you have to kind of weed through that and try to get the information that is specific to the problem, which is discrimination. And then in the end, nobody's stories equaled the story of the person that felt they were being discriminated against. So and they work different times. They don't, they didn't all work together, like say in an office. So it wasn't, that it was us against them or whatever. So in the end, it was that, this person wanted to find a reason for bringing a discrimination action against this company, and it turned out to not be the case just because of that.
And there's a difference too between truly false allegations of discrimination,
yes,
brought for bad motive, mm-hmm, and allegations where the person believed that, for example, they were terminated or demoted or suffered some discipline because they were in a protected class. But in fact, if you look at the record of what happened, look at objective evidence, there was a good sound basis for it that had nothing to do with the protected class status. But there's a difference between a complaint made in good faith, believing discrimination, and a complaint made for malicious purposes.
One of the things that we always recommend is that part of the policy include a statement about the consequences for making a false complaint, And I typically recommend that the discipline for that equal the discipline for someone who's been found guilty of discrimination, harassment, or retaliation. Mm-hmm. So a very clear statement that false complaints will be taken seriously and handled with appropriate mm-hmm. discipline is part of, I believe, a good solid policy.
When it comes to the investigation, then we have at least a complainant and an alleged harasser. Do we put them on paid administrative leave? Do we suspend them and reinstate depending on the outcomes of the investigation? Or do we let business as usual with them while the investigation is underway?
Do you want to give the lawyer's answer, or should I?
My answer is remove them from contact with each other. Sometimes that's feasible and sometimes that isn't, depending on the size of the employer. But the person, if it's a supervisor and a subordinate, they should not have contact with each other during the investigation. It really needs to be decided first whether anything actually did occur that was discrimination or harassment.
And again, you know, I think that the answer to your question, Bob, depends largely on the circumstances.
Okay. Well, we're talking about sexual harassment now. So we take it seriously.
Absolutely.
But
it makes a difference whether it's an employee and a supervisor,
right,
or two employees in a peer relationship, or an employee and a customer, or a vendor.
Right, and that's something we haven't discussed mm-hmm. yet. We've been talking about it under the assumption it's a workplace event.
Correct.
Right. This could be the receptionist being harassed by
Absolutely.
A package delivery fellow.
Right.
You know, I mean,
it also makes a difference whether or not it was workplace conduct or conduct outside the workplace. Mm-hmm. And one of the areas of expansion that we've seen in sexual harassment litigation and liability over the last few years is the courts holding employers and their employees liable for off-site conduct.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's not part of our agenda.
You know? Well, but it's part of sexual harassment.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Right. We'll leave the office Christmas party out of it.
Referring more to social media and online activity.
Yeah. Mm.
Well, and that crosses lines with protected concerted activity and oh, geez.
Less so this week than 3 weeks ago, however.
Yes, yes,
thanks
yes.
to the new National
Labor
Relations Board.
And what we've done with suspensions in the past is we don't know who to believe. Suspension's a cooling off period. It's going to end in a number of different ways. Suspension continues with or without pay, reinstatement, whatever. But right now we need a cooling off period. We need to isolate and we need to focus on this. What about if the complainant says, I'm really embarrassed about this and I don't want you to do anything and I want you to not mention my name, but this and that happened. Have you had that happen?
I have not, but I would still, you have to investigate.
My rule is once I know, I have to do something.
You have
That's
to
right.
do something about it, yes.
Okay.
Yes.
That was easy. some companies have anti-nepotism policies. In part, I guess, if there's a consensual relationship between two adults in your office or plant or whatever the workplace, whether they're married or not, sometimes they go south, like sometimes relationships do, but can you talk a bit to the wisdom of anti-nepotism policies and their relevance or appropriateness? Should we do them? Should we not have them? In a way, it seems counterproductive. You have two good workers.
Bob, are you asking about a new dating policy? Is that
pretty much because obviously it's going to lead to people being in a relationship that they didn't have a relationship when they were both hired and now suddenly they do. Chain of command, maybe they shouldn't be in the same chain of command to recognize the realities
yeah.
of life. But at the same time, an absolute, no, one of you has to quit.
In my experience, what's more effective is to require disclosure as opposed to banning people from engaging
okay.
in personal
mm-hmm.
relationships.
Okay.
Once you require the disclosure, you can then deal with whether or not they're in a chain of command and how mm-hmm. the organization wants to deal with that. And again, it depends on the size of the organization and the layers and levels that are available. Okay. One of the things to be careful about is if you're going to take the position that you don't want employees who are involved in a personal relationship to be working in a chain of command, make sure that your policy about who to transfer doesn't have an adverse impact.
Okay, right. Good point. Is one claim enough to warrant discipline as opposed to don't do that again? And if we write people up for what our investigation found to in fact be a valid allegation, does that stay in their file forever? Or is it protected information, privileged information, whatever? So is the first question is one claim enough to warrant discipline?
Yes.
At least a documentation of the file so that if it repeats itself, it's documented. Because many employers have progressive discipline policies.
Right. I mean, if you come in and start shooting up the place, I'm not going to give you a warning first. You know, you're fired.
If there's a finding, if there's some justification,
does that
based
stay
on
in
the
their file the forever, or is it like a 6-month time, or if you're a good boy for or a good girl for 2 years, it comes out? I mean,
there's actually some recent case law on that suggests that you really do need to keep it in the file forever. There's some recent case law that has held that. Failure to, and not only that, but there's a growing movement towards failure to warn resulting in liability for employers who don't warn subsequent employers.
I think digital and written are very much forever. I think the limitation is you document an incident. Maybe it's an incident which is not terribly serious, but a rule violation that needed to be corrected. Maybe it's a more serious incident with a warning that future conduct may warrant dismissal. There has to be a point where it's not considered, where there's
Correct.
Been good behavior, a person made an inappropriate joke 10 years ago, that really should, and has had a stellar record since. Should that be considered when they're up for promotion 10 years from now? Probably not.
But you can document that as well. I mean, and I encourage our clients to do that. For example, mm-hmm. when you have documented an incident and either disciplined or simply documented and a period of time goes by, you may document a discussion that you have with that employee where you're complimentary of their change in their behavior mm-hmm. So that's in the file as well. And that's, I think, how you can ameliorate in a fashion the fact that that's always going to be there.
Right.
Okay. Jenny, I was going to ask you with in interviewing processes, and you do that a lot with recruiting and obviously and trying to have an intake. I know in our field, we can come right out and ask applicants if you've ever had a HIPAA violation. We need to know that. Not that it's going to bar you from employment, but if you've had issues with privacy of protected health information, we must ask that. That's statutory. But in the interview is a screening process. Are you trained to look for any propensity or past engagements elsewhere so you don't hire Charles Manson?
Typically, people will volunteer more information than you're asking. And typically in conversation, things will come up. Things will come up, and you'll know if somebody has an angry streak and, I got mad and threw something and that's why I got fired. You know, you're going to understand a lot about a person through the conversation you're having. And it's not necessarily, that it's detrimental to the job they're going to do, but mm-hmm. the behavior and the way they comported themselves, it's just not conducive to the workplace, and then you just don't need to move any further with that person.
I mean, HIPAA violation really goes to conduct, not protected class status.
Right.
It's when you're getting into questions that tend to screen out for protected class status.
Right.
I think that's when you can get into a lot of trouble with interviews, when you start asking questions about a person's marital status or child care arrangements,
right.
for example.
Yeah.
One of the interview questions that I really like that can help uncover whether or not you may be dealing with somebody who has an issue is, tell me about a time where you didn't get along with a coworker and how you handled that.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And that's a way to inquire without violating any protected mm-hmm. status, but still mm-hmm. begin to get them talking about how they interact with other people.
Mm-hmm.
So mostly you're basing your question around behaviors, not specific life events or you know, things that they that would, you know, be prohibited questions.
Yeah, I mean, as long as you're careful not to be asking certain questions of certain applicants based upon stereotypes.
Right.
And you're asking the same questions of everyone.
Well, I know it's the old dictum, hire hard, manage easy, and so you want to put as many gates in there and speed bumps as you can on that road to be certain. Mm-hmm. But with sexual harassment, it's dynamic, it's vague, it's amorphous, but at the same time, it's very real and it's going to impact a lot of people. And so how can you always be on guard? Eventually there's fatigue.
Yes, but everything you always needed to know, you learned in kindergarten.
Tis true. Well, in the 4 minutes we have left, I'd like to give each one of you an opportunity, closing comments, do's and don'ts, and I'll need 30 seconds for recognizing people at the end.
For me, in my practice, what I see is that the easiest way for employers to handle sexual harassment is to not start there. But to start with the workplace culture and create through their behaviors, through their training,
preventive
through their policies,
practices. Yep.
All of those things working together, so, and your hiring practices, mm-hmm. so that you have a workforce that understands and values a workplace where people treat each other with respect.
Right. Exactly. That's important.
Yeah. Joan? And to expand on that, lead by example. Emphasize that a workplace should be a professional and respectful place. And don't hesitate to contact us, to contact your attorneys with any questions you may have about hiring, disciplinary actions, demotions, firing, anytime that you, and if there is a complaint, how to handle it. Because it's better to come to us with a question and have us answer it and have us help you, and we can help you, than to have to deal with it when a mistake has been made.
Okay,
and regarding training, employers have to really pay attention to the training that is given on sexual harassment. So the training should be different to the population and different for supervisors or anybody that has people that report directly to them, because there are specific things that supervisors must do and are tasked with that mm-hmm. that, you know, they need to understand the ramification of sexual harassment and what to do in the case of anything being brought to them, or even to be aware of it themselves, so
right.
they aren't the people doing what they don't need to do.
Yep, well said. So we want to document everything. We want to understand the laws. We want to have and follow policies. Have to have a culture of fairness, being approachable, and holding people accountable, because it's not okay. So with that, I want to certainly thank the panel here and Debra Franklin, Vice President of Human Resource Solutions from Murray Securus. Thank you very much, and definitely have you back.
Thank you, Bob.
And Joan London, an attorney with Kozloff Stout. Good luck with your presidency, Madam President.
Thank you.
With the Berks County Bar. And Jenny Batista, a corporate recruiter with Buckeye Partners and a board member of our Society for Human Resource Management, Chapter 179 here in Berks County. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Bob.
We'd like to thank the people here at BCTV, and especially John, Shane, and Karen here and behind the cameras and in the control room, volunteers whose work we could not bring you these programs, and certainly Chet Mosteller at Mosteller & Associates, the full-service professional HR consulting firm out there in the Route 10 Green Hills Morgantown Road area, and their contact information, 610-779-3870. And certainly our chapter, you can reach us at 610-929-3678, and both of these pieces of information will be on the screens at the bottom of the program. Well, our administrative director, Wendy, will be happy to chat with you about becoming a member. And that is our program for tonight. Our next program is March 13th, and the topics will be diversity and inclusion. Thank you and good night.